Okay, guys, in this video lesson, what we're going to do is going to introduce circular motion and kind of get us rolling about that, okay? So first thing, we'll do a little quick example here of a video, but if we're in circular motion, we're talking about movement anytime that we are forced or bound into a circle, okay? So we're talking about taking a curve with your car. We're talking about spinning a yo-yo. We're talking about a softball player throwing a pitch or a baseball player throwing a pitch, that kind of stuff. In case where we're taking an object and we're forcing it along some sort of circular path, okay? This is not the same as projectiles where we launch them and let gravity cause this projectile or this parabolic motion. It's a true circular path that we're talking about here, okay? So here's a quick example.
It is time for the women's hammer final here at the Olympic Stadium in Rio de Janeiro.
Now we'll get a look at the hot favorite once again. This is her second time in the cage. It was with her second throw winning her first world championship in 2009 that she injured her left ankle and needed surgery while celebrating. So she doesn't mind getting it out there, and she's done it again. She knew on release that this was big. It's beyond 80 again. She's the only woman in the world to do it. She's done it three now, four times. Is she en route to a world record here? That might be the gold right there for Wladaczek of Poland.
Well, this looks like it's the gold medal throw, if nothing else. Just under a world record, I think. It's over 80 metres, but is it 81? Maybe not, but gee, in fact, you can see the world record there. Yeah. She's about a half a metre underneath the world record.
All right, so as you can see in this example, you know, she had to generate all kinds of force to get that hammer to be thrown very, very far. Okay, so we think about it as she's spinning, right? That hammer is attached to her. She's generating all the force on the inside of that thing, spinning it around and around and around and around, and then she has to release it. Okay, so as she releases it, then she has to know right when to release it, so when it leaves her, it flies off in the right direction she wanted to fly off into. Now, obviously, it flew off in a parabolic motion, being a projectile, but you notice that once she released it, it flew straight. Okay, it didn't fly and continue to curve like you would see as it went around and spun in a circle. But the second she let go of it, it flew in a straight line into the air and flew straight down the field for where it landed. Okay, so we're going to talk about that and kind of what that means to us. All right, so what we're looking at here is velocity. So what is actually happening to this movement or this object as it is spinning around a circle? Okay, so things that are the same. We're still measuring in meters per second. It's still a vector, so speed and direction still matter for us, okay? Even though the object is rotating, we still want to look at it in terms of linear velocity, okay? So we don't want to look at the velocity as it curves through the thing. What we want to look at is, what would the velocity be this instantaneous point in time in this linear kind of pathway, okay? Imagine if this was the person, and she was throwing the hammer. Here's the long rope that she had, or cable, whatever it was, and the ball on the end of that. The second she lets go, it leaves and flies away on that linear path. That's what we were worried about here, okay? We call that linear velocity a tangential velocity, okay? Because it is tangent to the circular motion that we're seeing here, all right? Now, that velocity is what we're going to focus on. It's going to allow us to find accelerations and forces and everything else as we go forward. This video is another one that kind of gives us another example of that and brings us down into this idea of acceleration and force. So here you go.
This is a great demonstration for showing that if something's moving in a circle and you remove the centripetal force, it'll move in a straight line. But if you're teaching circular motion, I've got another demonstration that's worth doing first. Right, so as a physics teacher, I knew when to lift the hoop because I knew the ball would go off at a tangent. The ball goes from moving in a circle to moving in a straight line. And we know from Newton's first law that if something is moving in a straight line at a steady speed, the resultant force on it is zero. So what's going on when it's in the hoop? Well, the hoop exerts a contact force on the ball at right angles to its surface, and that force changes the velocity of the ball. The force is always directed towards the centre of the hoop, the centre of the circle. take away that force and the ball obeys Newton's first law and carries on moving in a straight line.
Okay, so what he's looking at here is this idea is the second we remove that centripetal force he was identifying, then we're going to follow Newton's law. Okay, remember that's a law of inertia. So remember inertia is something that it resists the change in motion. So go back to that first law, an object at rest stays at rest, an object in motion stays in motion. Well, the ball wants to stay moving the same direction at all times. The hoop was making a change. The second we remove the hoop, it no longer has to change, so it now will continue to move in the same manner it was, which is tangent to our circle, okay? Now, if we want to solve for the velocity of something moving in a circle, we had to be able to build an equation from that. We know that our equation for velocity is change in displacement over change in time, right? It's a delta x over delta t. However, we really don't have a normal displacement here because we have a rotation about the same axes over and over and over again. So if we start here and go all the way around, the displacement is technically zero, okay? So we have to have a new way of identifying what that displacement is in terms of what's going on here. And what we do is we don't look at it from the standpoint of how far does it travel, okay? We look at it from the standpoint is what is the circumference of our circle that we are generating, okay? So to find displacement, we need the circumference, all right? Now, if you remember, circumference, we usually find that or solve for that by knowing the radius of our circle. So if we can find the radius of our circle, we then can use the equation for circumference, or 2 pi r, to find that overall circumference. Along the same timeline, or along the same idea, as this thing moves around in a circle, what we see happen is it takes a certain amount of time to get around, but it repeats on itself over and over and over and over again. Okay? So when we measure time for circular motion, just like having a single circumference, we want to know the time it takes to make one revolution around that circle, right? That single revolution is called a period, okay? Or the period of revolution, we sometimes call that. We use a capital T instead of a lowercase t. That reminds us that this is actually a period and not just a random amount of time, okay? And by doing this, we now are saying, well, the ball has to travel one full circumference in one set amount of time or one period. Well, that's going to be a change in displacement over a change in time, and that was going to be our velocity. So to solve for that, we start with this, delta x over delta t. We substitute in the 2 pi r for delta x. We substitute in t for change in time, and we get an equation where our velocity would be 2 pi r over our big T, okay, or our period here. All right. So as long as we know the radius, and as long as we know the period or the time it takes to go around one revolution, we can figure out how fast it moves at any point in time tangent to the circular motion, okay? Or what is the linear velocity that's going on as you are moving in a circle, all right? We're going to end the video lesson here. We'll have some practice problems and some homework for you guys to do on velocity, but we're going to add acceleration to that first. In our next video, we will start tackling acceleration. Thank you.